Hey, brothers and sisters, this is my second video, and this is a message I just got through praying before I made that last video about the orphanage. And this is Brother Patrick in the Philippines. I'm a missionary here and a pastor to the body of Christ through YouTube. Praise the Lord for the technology that's been used for so much evil, internet porn and all that stuff. Number one producer of internet porn in the world is the United States. And the number one producer are preachers, Bibles, preaching and all that, United States. Praise the Lord for that. With that two-edged sword of the internet, the two-edged sword of the United States. So thank the Lord. Me and you right now are on the right side of the sword today. Praise the Lord for that. May we always be on the right side of the sword of the Lord in His will and not in sin. Anyway, brothers and sisters, while I was praying a little while ago, the Lord reminded me of the story of the prodigal son. And really, it's for backsliders. And the Lord wanted me to talk to people who are backsliding today. If you watch this video, you're a backslider. God wants to talk to you. And this is what the Lord told me. He said that, you know, people, lots of you guys who are backsliders, you come from a denominational background that tells you that you can say a prayer when you're 8 years old or 10 years old or 12 years old or 20 years old. Say what they call the sinner's prayer. And then live like hell the rest of your life, even maybe even deciding maybe you might be atheist. You're not sure. You're agnostic. You don't really know if God's real or not. You're not sure anymore. Then you're living your own life and living your own will, and then you die and you're going to go to heaven. Now, that's what lots of people believe, and that's what these denominations are teaching. You know what? That's why that's a pretty popular idea. I mean, if you think about it, it's got to be a popular idea. And it reminds me of the words of Jesus when he says, straight is the gate and narrow is the way that leads to salvation, to go to heaven. And few are there that find it. And then broad is the road. You know, wide is the road that leads to destruction. And many are going there. So there's only a few people, a small percent of people in the world who will go the narrow way. So the idea right off the bat doesn't sound like it's a narrow way when you say, hey, you can just do whatever you want, live like hell all your life because you said a prayer when you were 8 years old. Maybe you believed it, or you said, you know, you don't even remember what you were thinking at that time. But now you're not even sure if God's real, and you think, well, whatever, if it all works out, I said a prayer, I'm going to heaven. My grandma told me if I said a prayer, I'm going to heaven. Like my grandma, who says, is once saved, always saved. And I got two brothers. I shouldn't say, well, I do. I have two brothers who are agnostics. And then my grandma said, oh, they're going to heaven. Because I was there when they went to the altar when they were little kids. And I was there when they got baptized. I was too. They say they don't believe it. They deny the Lord. Ain't no way. There ain't no way. That is absolutely not what the Bible says. And that's why I'm making this video. Now, we'll see what happened to the prodigal son. Let's see. There was a certain man that had two sons. This is in Luke chapter 15, verse 11. A certain man, Jesus is talking, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided unto them his living, you know, gave him his inheritance. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, then wasted his substance with riotous living. He partied. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land. And he began to want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his field to feed the pigs, or swine. And he would faint, have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. So nobody gave him anything to eat. He had to eat the corn husk that the pigs were eating. And when he came to himself, this is a part that the Lord spoke to me. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he rose and came to his father, and when he was yet afar off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring forth the best robe, and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, and shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf, and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead, and is alive again. He was lost, and is found. And they begin to make merry. I want to stop right there. People love to get off track about the older brother being jealous. Let's don't talk about that right now. Everybody loves to make a message out of that. Let's talk about the main point of this message. Is it? And this is what the Lord wanted me to ask you in the title of this video. Have you come to yourself yet? All those people that talk about you can live in sin in a backslidden state, go to heaven. It didn't say, this parable is telling us that the young man, because he was in such a bad shape and had so much hell in his life, and that's what's wrong with you. Even all the my relatives and people I know, almost all of my relatives are backsliders. If never was is probably more like, in truth be known, never was is, but let's just say they was is born again, and now they're backsliders, and their life is no peace, no joy. Their life is turmoil and a living hell. It's like being in a typhoon or a tornado every day. But yet, in their arrogance and hard-headedness, they have not come to themselves like this guy did. So this is the point. He came to himself and he said, hey, I need to go tell my dad I repented before I've sinned against God and before you, and just treat me like a servant, like a slave. I'm nothing. In other words, he said, like the Jesus talked about the Pharisee and the tax collector who went into the temple, and the tax collector, or in the King James, it didn't call them tax collectors. That's the right term. The publicans, not Republicans, but publicans or tax collectors. And Jesus said that the Pharisees looked up into heaven like the older brother in this story and said, you know, thank you, God, I'm not like this tax collector, this sinner. You know, I fast twice a week. I get, you know, I tithe, blah, 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 like that. And then the publican was like this younger brother who said, the publican, you know, said he didn't even look up. He looked down at the ground, hit himself in the chest and said, you know, God, forgive me, I'm a sinner. And Jesus said that second son was justified. Or the second one, the tax collector was justified because he said, hey, I'm a sinner. And that's it. They wouldn't even look up at God. So, in this story that I'm just reading to you about the prodigal son, this prodigal son came to himself and said, hey, I'm in a mess because I'm not with my father. I have wasted my life. I'm not doing God's will. I'm not being obedient to my father. And I'm in a mess. I'm in a pig pen, starving to death, eating the husk. I'm eating pig slop. And I'm in a mess. And I need to go repent and go home to my father. And when he went home, his father received him. He killed the fatted calf. He put a robe on him. In other words, he didn't treat him as a servant. He treated him as a son and received him back unto himself. Now, if that son, and this is the part that nobody's saying, and this is the part I'm saying to you, backslider, if he had not come to himself, he would have sat in that pig pen and starved to death. It says nobody gave him nothing to eat. No, God's not going to let nobody keep doing that. Keep propping you up, propping you up. That's the fake love. That's the thing I see with the backsliders in my family. They get in trouble. They're drunks. They get in all this mess. And then another backslider comes along and stopping God from bringing them to the point of repentance and finding themselves. Instead of them being crushed down under the weight of the harvest of their own sin to the point where they would say, hey, I am in a big pile of pig poop and I need to repent. Or die. There's lots of people that God has to push to that point. Repent or die. Now, God brings judgment on backsliders. God brings judgment on backsliders much more than the lost that never was. Because you're supposed to know better. God will put you under the crush. And then the devil's people come in and keep trying to prop you up, prop you up. Here, let me pay your house payment for you. Let me pay your rent for you. Oh, I got somebody that can give you another job, even though you've been fired from 20 jobs. You've been drunk all the time. You won't go to work. Here's something. We're going to help you. Keep propping them up. And there's lots of Christians that do that too for their grown children. And they're just, you know, they're blocking the grace of God manifested through judgment. They're blocking the person from repenting by trying to be a propitiation, by trying to stand between that prodigal son and the judgment of God that God's trying to put on them to bring them to the point of coming to themselves. Now, if most of you guys are watching this video, now that I think about it, as the Lord is leading me, you're probably the one who's blocking God with your what you think is love, but it's not love. It's the world's love. It's not tough love, agape love that God has. You're blocking the hand of God from bringing judgment unto repentance upon the prodigal son or daughter that's in your life. Get out of the way and let God bring this prodigal child of yours to the point of repentance, where they're ready to receive grace. And those of you who may be watching this, who happen to stumble upon this video, and you are a backslider, God is not going to let up off of you until you come to yourself, because God loves you and He does not wish none to perish. He doesn't want you to perish and go to hell. He wants you to come to repentance. And God chastens those whom He loves. He spanks, He disciplines, He judges those who He loves. He's trying to bring you to yourself. There's no reason why you have to go all the way to rock bottom. There's no reason why you got to go to the bottom. Don't go to the bottom. Why let God keep crushing you and crushing you and crushing you? Why wake up tomorrow morning and find out, oh, you got cancer and you got 6 months to live? Then the next thing you know, you're running there, you get saved, you get right with God. Maybe you get healed, maybe you don't. A big chance that you go ahead and leave this world and you go to heaven and say, well, if he hadn't got cancer, he would have lived to be 80 and died in his sins and gone to hell. Don't let that have to happen to you. Don't let God have to bring down the hammer on you. Don't be like this prodigal son. Come to yourself today. Come back to the Lord today. Just the other parable that the Lord tells. He leaves that 99 sheep and goes after the one. He said, what shepherd having 100 sheep doesn't leave the 99 and go after the one? And then when he finds that sheep, they rejoice over the one they found. Jesus tells a story in the same text about the woman who has the 5 gold coins. She loses a gold coin. She turns the house upside down. Even though she's still got 4 gold coins, she turns the house upside down to find the gold coin that she lost. And then when she finds it, she tells all of her friends, hey, guess what? I found that coin that I lost. Yay! And they celebrate and rejoice that she found the lost coin. That's just like you, and that's just like me. The Bible says, Jesus said, the angels in heaven rejoice whenever a sinner comes to repentance. Now I'm talking about lost people and the backslidden. Don't let anybody fool you that you can live in sin all your life doing your own will and God's going to drag you kicking and screaming to heaven. As a famous preacher once said, if you don't like going to church, if you don't like listening to worship music and reading the Bible, you'll hate heaven. Heaven will be hell to you. If you don't like listening to praise and worship, you're going to hate heaven because there's lots of praise and worshiping going on up there. If you don't want to hear about Jesus and talk about Jesus today, like a brother I got in California, a brother in the Lord in California, whose wife gets berserk if she hears the name of Jesus, heaven would be hell to her because that's what all they're talking about. Hallelujah, praise the Lamb of God, praise the Alpha and Omega, praise the Son of the living God. It would be like fingernails on a chalkboard to her. So why in the world would God drag anybody kicking and screaming into heaven? Don't worry about it. He's not going to do it. God honors our free will, and as many a famous preacher has said, that the door of hell is locked on the inside. People lock themselves in hell when they reject the grace of God. Now this prodigal son, thank God, even though he did all those bad things, he came to himself because he got down to the level of pig manure and eating corn husk, eating pig slop, and sitting in a pile of pig manure, which for a Jew is unclean. Of course, it's unclean for anybody. Manure, sitting in a pile of it, starving to death, and acting like a fool, living a riotous, drunk life, and living as a fool. He finally came to his senses when he had nothing else, nowhere else to go. Even then, the Father received him back when he came home. And that's the point. This son of mine who was lost, he's now found. God wants to do the same thing in your life and in the life of your family member. Get out of the way of the grace of God moving through judgment. God bless you guys. Love you guys. I'll see you. I'll be in the States February, the first week of March. Anywhere in the Southwest, Southern United States this time. It's too cold to go up north. I may go up a little bit. Depends on as the Lord leads me. Message me. Invite me. Tell me what's going on. By the grace of God, we'll pray about it, whether I can make it or not. I'm open to go anywhere in the United States as the Lord leads.